So we're here playing some Fire in the Lake. This is Nick and I, and I'm Jeremy. And there's Nick.
Hello.
And we've just sort of got set up here. We're going to do a little short game. I got the deck all set up, and the two sides we're going to have is Nick is going to play NVA and the VC. He's the bad guys.
Yep. And from, you know, from the USA perspective.
Yeah, totally. But I'm playing USA, so from my perspective, you are the bad guy. So yeah, as you can probably guess, I'm playing the US and Arvin, the Army Republic of Vietnam. And that's actually a really interesting point you just brought up there, is that this game is, you know, American-centric in a lot of ways. You know, they definitely use a lot of the American terms for everything, which is understandable. This is definitely an American-made game about America's involvement in Vietnam.
You know, I was watching... I was listening to The Splendid Table because I was driving somewhere on Sunday, and they were talking about, I think it was Laos, the people of Laos.
Mm-hmm.
They were operatives employed by the CIA during the Vietnam War.
Oh, yeah.
Trying to, like, make sure that our soldiers didn't get captured and to really annoy the hell out of them when they were in their territory and stuff like that. I had no idea that existed.
Yeah, there's a lot about this war. I mean, I'm not a huge expert on Vietnam by any stretch of the imagination, but there's a lot of mystery and, like, ins and outs about it that still probably has not been really talked about. A lot of implications, a lot of, you know, the follow-up, the lead-up to it. You know, I was watching, I don't know if you've ever seen a documentary, The Fog of War, that's got McNamara. I think, who did that one? I forget. Some famous weird documentary guy that basically sets up his people in a room and he has a box that projects his voice. And then he just records them, so he's not in the room with them, but he has this box that sort of has his floating voice in it. And it's pretty interesting. It's all about McNamara, and it's like the lessons of war or whatever, and a lot of it has to do with his, you know, about Vietnam and stuff like that. So it's an interesting perspective. You're definitely, you kind of see he's kind of he's having some reflections on it. It's a cool documentary.
Yeah.
And it talks a little bit about Vietnam, not all of it. A lot of it's like World War II and then Cuban Missile Crisis and stuff, so...
It's, what's his name? Errol Morris.
There we go.
The Brief History of Time documentary.
Yeah. That guy, it's pretty interesting. So yeah, that's one thing I was watching the other day to sort of get back in the mindset of what this is about. All right, so we got everything set up here. We'll just play through, and, if, you know, definitely just go at your own speed since, this is probably your first time playing it. So yeah, no worries on that. Let's just have fun and figure it out.
Should we give a bit of an example of, I guess, what this game is? Because this is, what, the fourth game or the fifth game?
This is fourth in the series. So the first one was Andy and Abyss. That's sort of the first game that really pioneered the series. And it was about the Colombia counterinsurgency situation that took place in sort of the mid-90s, sort of after Escobar's been killed. And the Cali cartel. Was he Cali or Medellin? Whatever cartel he ran got broken up, and then... that's sort of where the game takes place. And so in that one, you played, you know, the Colombian government, and you were fighting their very long-term insurgency with the FARC, which were Marxist guerrillas that advocated, you know, redistribution of land and wealth to the countryside. And they've been fighting for years and years and years, like 30, 40 years.
Yeah.
And so the first game was all about them fighting that and the AUC, which were some right-wing sort of paramilitary death squads that popped up. And then also, of course, the cartels. And I think the big feature of all coin games is that it's multiplayer. You can play it 1 to 4 players, but it always has 4 factions. And I think they're going to design ones that have 3 factions in the future. But it's always faction-based. And it's asymmetric. So everybody has different kind of abilities and capabilities. And then they use those to achieve their own peculiar, unique victory conditions.
Okay.
So in this one, you know, this is the fourth one. This is definitely probably the most involved. I mean, I've helped playtest Andy and Abyss and then A Distant Plane, which is about Afghanistan, the conflict in Afghanistan with the U.S. And there's another one, Cuba Libre, that's about Castro and his insurgency against Batista. And I've had people ask me if they want to play coin games, what's a good one to start with. And that's probably a good one to start with because has all the same basic design features and you know, it's everything the coin games are. It's just a much smaller map. It's an island. And so it's a little bit more focused. You don't have this sort of sprawling options.
Yeah.
This map is definitely the biggest. I think A Distant Plane is very big too, but you sort of have more condensed areas. You definitely have natural places where people operate. I think, you know, the warlords operate in the north and the Taliban kind of takes over the south.
Yeah.
Here is it's definitely a long, skinny, you know, kind of territory, but you'll have a lot of places to go. There's a lot of options. So that's why this is definitely the most involved game, I think, so far. It's got the most bells and whistles in terms of just options and diversity of pieces, you know. So we'll talk about that.
It's complicated anyway.
Yeah, and I mean, that's kind of the thing. The coin games themselves, I mean, the rules aren't necessarily too crazy, but it's the interaction of everything. It's hard to, first time people, when you play this, it's hard to put it all together to think, what are the small steps I take through my actions to win the game? To, you know, so if you're the NBA, your goal is to get bases and control of the countryside. So you have to be building up your infrastructure, but you also have to be asserting real force in areas and taking them over. That takes, you know, that's not so self-explanatory when you're reading the rules about how to get that done. But it's one of those things where once you start, you know, messing with it and playing with it, it definitely, it becomes clear. I think you start seeing what's up and then you start getting a better feel for it. And so, yeah, initially I think this first few turns is going to be sort of feeling your way out. And then as you start getting more of a position, you start figuring out what you need to do.
So I'm a little familiar with these games, mostly because I've been playing a lot of Discipline to try to kind of acclimate myself to this rule set. This one has the same sort of victory conditions. If a coup card comes up, you check what's going on the outskirt track.
Yeah, like what we're going to do is, so periodically throughout the deck, we'll start playing, and then the coup cards are sort of like, yeah, victory point checks. It's when you stop, play, you reset some things, some people have to move, you get resources, so it's like when the government gets paid, it's when everybody kind of gets paid, and then you also check for victory then. And so if a faction has achieved victory at a coup card, you know, game over, that faction wins.
Okay.
If you get to the end, then it's like whoever's closest to winning wins the game.
And I guess for the weirdest thing, I think, or the hardest concept for me to wrap my head around was patronage.
Yes.
Which essentially means how, people have kind of skirted around this, but it essentially means how corrupt a particular faction is. Is that a good way to say it?
So, like, the patronage is really key for the ARVN forces, the Army of the Republic of Vietnam. So their goal in the game here is to establish coin control. You'll see these little markers, like there's one in Quang Nam, there's one in Hue, or Hue, it looks like Hue, but I think it's Hue. And you'll see those markers. That's part of what they have to do. Their goal is to basically go around and also kind of like the NBA, they just want to establish control over areas. But the other way they win is by cultivating patronage. And so you're right. I think Distant Plain was the first one to have this. It was called patronage. I think originally it was called graft or something. And what it was is the way they explain it is that it's taking resources that was given to the Saigon regime and they're redistributing it to their own kind of cronies, maybe their own sort of support elites. You know, this is the handing out of, you know, it's basically like if you think of old time Chicago or something, right? The black people think about this, or Louisiana, right? Like it's handing out these little patronage gigs to your supporters as you come into power to stay in power. It's just a way of solidifying it. So yeah, it definitely can be seen as corrupt. It can also just be seen as sort of like how things work, you know, and that's just sort of how this government works. And I think if you think of like the U.S., definitely with like earmarks or something that senators can do, the kind of way they can steer money. You know, some people could definitely be like, that's patronage too.
Everywhere else but America is corruption.
Basically, yeah, we're a shining beacon on a hill. So we are so incredibly awesome. But yeah, so I mean, I think there's a lot of debate on that, and that's really another interesting part of this game is that there are going to be things that, you know, have a lot of meaning based on how you see it, you know? And so a lot of people do look at patronage, and some will say, well, that's just totally ARVN or the Republic of Vietnam being, you know, the leaders being very corrupt, you know, and sacrificing the people's will for, you know, people's benefit for their own, you know.
Okay.
Some people might come in and say, no, that's just how you had to get things done, you know, like different cliques ran different parts of the, you know, government, and that's just how you grease the wheels, you know, you got to give some people money. So yeah, I mean, there's lots of those little things in the coin games like this that's not necessarily ambiguous, but just open to interpretation, you know, definitely wide-ranging. It's like there's terror markers in this game. Like you commit terror to, you know, change the way people feel in a countryside, and that could be a lot of different things. So,
yeah,
that's what's interesting about this game too. I find it's really nice. It definitely is abstract. I mean, we're just playing with little wooden pieces here, as you can see. Well, they're digital, but in real life, they're wooden pieces, And you don't see the sort of conventional, like, standard war game stuff. You know, you don't see a lot of just troops and, you know, attack values, defense values, all that kind of thing. Here it's a lot more abstracted. So you get a lot more of that range of meaning, you know, when you abstract stuff like that.
So I'm trying to think of what other stuff we should cover before we get in there. Does this game use the same undercover agent system?
Yes. So what you'll see, you'll probably, if you're looking here, you see lots of different colors of pieces. And the red one is NVA. That's their color. The blue is the VC, the Viet Cong. The yellow and orange cubes are Arvin. And the reason they have two different color cubes is that one of their the yellow ones are troops. These represent sort of, you know, the guys that have boots on the ground, the guys who get in trucks that go and, you know, fight, you know, wherever.
Yeah.
And the orange are more police, and that's just standard, like, you know, civil protection kind of people, right? It's police like you know and see on your streets every day, right? And the green is the U.S., and so they sort of just are all green. The thing is that the insurgent factions, they use mostly, and this game kind of changes that, but in other games, insurgents pretty much always were the cylinders. You see those little kind of octagon,
yeah.
They're octagons, right? No, they're hexagons. Is that right? Six-sided? Yeah.
Yeah.
So they use cylinders, and the way that, you know, this game works is that to model an insurgency, the idea is that you have underground cells, essentially. Those are very small, concentrated groups of people trying to get things done. And when you want to activate them to do something like do an ambush or conduct a terror operation or sometimes to even do some of their other special activities, you know, they have to become active, like they become known. And so if they're underground, you can't just kill them if you're the other side, right? If I'm the U.S. and I land a bunch of troop cubes, we'll talk about that in some area, I can't just kill underground guys. I have to find them first. And that's something you do that's called sweeping. It's one of the actions you have to do. And sweeping will uncover these guys, right? It's like concentrated effort of you focusing on some, you know, area to find guerrillas. Only when things are exposed, like I'll flip a guy over. So we're here in North Vietnam. If for some reason that guy went active, you'll see he's got a little star on him right now. That means he's been activated and that he can be targeted with airstrikes. He could be targeted by troop cubes coming in and just, you know, taking them out in conventional fighting. That's a big part of being an insurgent, is that you have what they call the, like, information advantage. So that's why you can always be underground, and people can sweep, but then they gotta wait a turn before they can kill you. It's very hard in this game to get the sweep and kill. You know, you can do it, but a lot of times you have to spend a whole turn sweeping, and then the next turn you have to spend time attacking. And so in between that, you know, that force can slip away, you know, those guerrillas can march away. Sometimes they can go back underground. The VC especially can do that. If it's in a space with one of their own bases, they can go underground pretty quickly. And that's just sort of the cat and mouse game that this counterinsurgency models. So that's a big part of it, is finding the guerrillas, exposing them, and then taking them out. But because it's slow and not necessarily efficient, you know, it's difficult to truly root these people out. You know, that's the whole point of insurgencies. It's kind of difficult to really get rid of an insurgency.
Yeah. And that's the thing that I've always loved about these corn games, is that even once you've stabilized an area, in your particular faction's idea of what stable means, you can, like, all it will take is two or three turns down the road, and everything will fall apart again.
Yes, exactly. And good insurgent factions will know that. You know, like, you're not going to win usually direct conflicts. This game's a little different in that the NVA is now actually has access to its own cubes, its own troops, and it can actually build up quite a large conventional force. You know, they don't have to rely totally on guerrillas. You know, the VC is all guerrilla based. They don't get any troops at all. So they have to use a lot more small clandestine actions. You know, they have to kind of nibble around the edges and attack sometimes in force, but that's, you know, that's not what guerrillas do well. You know, guerrillas are not really good at massing and being conventional. The troops are, you know, they're easier to kill. Troop cubes are the little square guys, okay? So we talked about police being the orange ones and then the troops being the yellow ones. For the U.S., you know, they have green troops, right? And then the NVA can get access to those red troop cubes. And they're just good for literally just going in and taking over areas, but also fighting, you know, and they fight much better than guerrillas. Guerrillas actually have to, like, roll a die. Like, so to attack with guerrillas, you have to mass them, and then they all go active when you attack with them because, of course, they're, you know, showing up out of the bush or coming out of the mountains, and they're just attacking. And you have to roll a dice, so it's not always guaranteed you're even going to be effective with guerrillas. Whereas troops, you just have to have numbers. It's a numbers game. Usually it's 2-1 for a lot of the troops for the NVA. Like, you have to have two of them to kill one other guy. That actually says it on the sheet. So as we start talking about attacking, you'll see that the U.S. is generally better at attacking. The NVA is not as good, but they have more guys. You know, it's that classic, like, small force really efficient versus much larger force that's inefficient, but, you know, has much more people. So yeah, those are the kind of cubes, and you'll see how it interacts as we kind of do it and move through. And honestly, that's this game is going to be, I think it's going to be a lot of fun to play, but it definitely is the most involved. You know, you have a lot of levels going on. So, you know, as we play through this initial stuff, I mean, I'll probably talk about my thought process of what I'm thinking of, because that's sort of how you just get in the swing of things.
Okay.
And just go for it.
That makes sense. I guess, because I've been kind of asking questions to try and give a bit of a baseline explanation of what we're doing. Like, the central way that you play this game is through the cards. Mm-hmm. Still in this game, right?
Right, so I was about to actually start the cards out. So you'll see over here on the right, I've got the deck here. Let's go ahead and just hit... It's so nice to have these little buttons here. We'll just hit draw card and draw card. Oh, so we're going to actually have a coup right away. That's going to be very interesting. That can happen. You can also draw the coup card as the first card. That's also very interesting. That definitely can happen. But yes, this game is driven by cards. And I think some people may have played things like Twilight Struggle, which is a very popular board game that GMT makes. It uses cards as the way you drive the action. And there's a lot of other card games like that where you get a hand of cards and you play the hand of cards. You know, the coin games are different in that you don't have a hand of cards. What you have is sort of this deck of cards that comes out. And so there'll be two you can always see. There'll be the current one, and then there'll be an upcoming one. So you can always see one card into the future. And the reason that's important is because these cards drive who gets to take their turn order. It drives a turn order, essentially. So you'll see there's four different symbols at the top of the card there. Like, I have Kent State kind of pulled up here. And you'll see
and
there's
that's definitely going to be a U.S. thing first.
Yes, and, well, actually, this is VC, then NBA, then the U.S., and the Arvin. So you see the colors at the top there. The blue one, it's all about the faction colors. So blue is VC, the red is NBA, we sort of have the green, and then Arvin goes last. So right now, since it's the very first turn, you know, we basically are going to look at the first two, because everybody, so I'm going to scroll down here. The way this works is we have this sort of sequence of play down here at the bottom. Let me zoom in on this. And this is really what's genius, I think, about this game system, is the way this works out. So we have Kent State. Let me go back to Kent State here. And you'll see that the blue circle is first. That means the VC has the first option on this card. They can decide what they want to do. And what they can do is down here. So if we go down back to our sequence of play, you'll see the top box here. It says first faction, operation only, no special activity. If I took that, if the VC decides, yeah, I'm going to just do an operation, which is a very limited amount of things they can do without doing something really nice, special activity, right? The special activities tend to be more powerful abilities for you to either attack or get money or do nicer things. You can move guys. It's pretty powerful to do special activities. If I choose this first thing and say, I'm just going to do op only, but no special activity, then whoever comes next on the card after I take my action, which in this case will be the NVA, because they have the red circle, they have to take the next one that says second faction limited op. They can't do anything else but that. They could pass, but that's that you're tracked on that, right? So whatever the first guy does directly impacts what the second person can do. If I was the NBA or the VC and I decided I'm going to take the event, you know, because these cards all have events on them, you'll see two kinds of events. There's what they call the shaded one and the unshaded. And shaded is sort of that darker part on the bottom. It tends to be more beneficial for the insurgents to play. It tends to be more of an insurgent event. And then the top part tends to be more counterinsurgent focused. So like with Kent State here, I'm the VC. I can pick either event. I'm not forced, if I'm the VC, to take the shaded one. And this is where, like, if you play a four-player game, this is where you get a lot of the negotiation sort of, you know, bribery or whatever, saying, hey, you know, you take this event or you do this and I'll give you money or I'll leave this area. You know, that's another great thing about this game. You do a lot of talking between people, especially with four players, because you're always trying to negotiate to get on top and to get the best kind of deal for you. So if I'm the VC and I see this, the shaded event says up to three troop casualties out of play. which means that if I had been killing guys, the U.S. pieces, when they get killed, they go to casualties. And then during a coup round, you sort of take some of those, and they're forever removed from the game. It's sort of just that sort of attritional warfare where people in the U.S. get less and less likely to want to send guys in as more and more people die. Yeah. He also reduces aid, and it keeps the U.S. ineligible to the next card. That's a pretty powerful event.
It's a very powerful event.
But it's not really powerful right now because I haven't killed anybody and or I haven't sent any troops to casualties. And since we're about to have a coup card, it's just not as effective right now. This would be a great card if, you know, this was the middle of the campaign and it came up and, you know, I could use that. So, you know, that event's not particularly attractive for me as a VC player, you know, if I was looking at that.
Yeah.
It might be, but at the same time, it's not. And the top part says, what, any two U.S. casualties to available. That's pretty nice. And one free limited op for the U.S. And the U.S. is eligible, which is, you know, that's pretty powerful for the U.S. as well. But as you can see on the card order, it's pretty unlikely that the U.S. is going to get first crack at this, you know.
Yeah.
So that's sort of the interesting part. A lot of these cards, you know, Kent State was considered not a great thing for U.S. morale. That's kind of why in the card order here, you see VC and NVA going first.
Yeah.
There are other events that'll come up that are much more U.S. positive or Arvin positive themed, and they'll be at the front of the line, you know. So that's interesting because the card order changes. So as we get other cards, you'll see this order at the top changes, and everybody has the same equal amount of card orders. So like there's the equal amount of ones where VC goes first as there are where the U.S. goes first. And just because you go first does not necessarily mean, as you'll see when we play, just not necessarily mean you're going to get the first crack at it. Because if this had been a round where only the U.S. and Arvin were available, you know, then the VC and NVA couldn't really do anything on this card.
Yeah. I always liked this particular mechanic because any event, I mean, the Kent State riots, mm-hmm. that was huge morale issue for the United States. But if it had gone a different way, it could have been a beneficial thing for the United States as well.
Right, exactly, right. You know, if you had better people handling, yeah, as it says here, you can kind of see the flavor text sort of indicates that, right? So you have the top one, National Guard imposes order versus National Guard overreacts. Yeah, totally.
Yeah. So you can see this event, I guess, in the actual war, the National Guard really overreacted.
Mm-hmm.
But if the National Guard had just had order and everything was looking good, it probably could have gone very well for the United States and actually maybe bolstered us to stay for a little bit longer. I don't know.
You know, well, it just wouldn't have been probably just so negative. You know, it just would have been, the way they phrase it here is it sounds like it's really beneficial, but the idea is like, you know, you just don't take that PR hit. You know, you don't take that. I mean, that's what I'm guessing. I mean, the designers, I think, in the playbook actually sort of rationale what they had of thinking of the event. Because, of course, there's a melee event in this game, and that has caused a lot of debate on Board Game Geek about are they really describing the terrible event. And for people who don't know, melee was a small detachment of U.S. troops committed quite egregious massacre on this one village and killed a lot of women and children. And it was definitely one of the turning points of the war in terms of, like, what are we doing here? And some people definitely feel like that card maybe didn't address the full aspect of it. You know, but there's only limited room for them to write stuff. And, you know, with something like Vietnam, these events are going to be really controversial. I don't think there were a lot of people who were looking at the Colombian cards in Andean Abyss and thinking, oh, that's a really controversial event, you know, because they just didn't know Colombian history.
Yeah, and even Afghanistan, like, we just didn't know. We still don't know a lot of what went on over there.
Yeah.
But here, it's far enough detached and it's pretty U.S.-centric that it's going to be... There's going to be a lot of emotions attached to the cards.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it'll be interesting as this game comes out. You know, I saw a lot of vets comment on A Distant Plane. You know, a lot of people were like, I like this game, and I'll never play the Taliban. You know, like, I'll never, ever be the Taliban player. Things like that. So it'll be interesting to see how this goes with Vietnam, because, yeah, it's just far enough in the past, and the Vietnam vets are getting old enough now that there's been a lot of reflection on it. And a lot of people this war is still very much in their minds, considering how wars are going today. So
yeah.
it's very interesting. I'll be interested to see how that develops anyway. So that's sort of the card. This is how the game moves, is the cards that drives all the action. And we just talked about the events, but it's totally possible that no event gets taken on this card, which sort of means like Kent State, you know, happened but wasn't a big deal. And so if the event doesn't get taken, it's not like that didn't happen. It's just that didn't become something really vital in this playthrough of the war, in this sort of sandboxing we're having of the war. So I guess we just might as well kick it off. The only thing we should mention is that we drew a coup card is next, and because of that, this card has the Monsoon written on it, which is really interesting that they programmed that in like that. The Monsoon is a game feature that sort of is a way to throw in. Obviously, Vietnam was an area where they had monsoons, and monsoons are pretty pretty major rainstorms. So if there's a monsoon, hold on, I wrote this down. You are restricted somewhat in what you can do. So for monsoons, we have, what is this? There's no sweeping, there's no marching, there's no pivotal events, but we don't have that. And airstrike and airlift can only be at max two spaces. So if that comes up, we'll show. But yeah, there's no sweeping and marching, so people won't be moving around. The reason they did that is because people found out in the other games that if you saw that the coup card was coming next, it was possible for some factions to win by just marching, you know, all their guys into one area to get control of something they needed, and that's put them over the victory. And you would never do that if the game was keeping, you know, was going to keep going, because it would be such a bad move, but it might win you the game. So they put rules in that said if the coup card comes up next, you get a lot of reduced action, so you can't just like grab somewhere and win, you know.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be a build-up and sort of you maintaining your hold on the top.
Okay, on the player aid cards, it says not in monsoon to the things that you can't do.
Yeah, and they've gotten better at that, which is really nice, because I think Ending Abyss had that rule, but it was tough, and people kind of forgot about it. In this game, they actually give you, like, I know when the physical game comes out, there's a little marker you actually place on the card that says monsoon, which is really nice, because that way it's just like a physical reminder, hey, you know, you can't do certain things.
Yeah.
So that's going to be very interesting how we start this game. So I guess you're the Insurgents, so you're going to get the first two cracks on this card, so yeah.
Should I hit undo to put my little guy back?
Oh, did you move a guy?
No, well, you put the Viet Cong guy.
Oh, I just moved the guy in the north. Did I move?
No, I meant in the sequence of play.
Oh, right, sorry, yeah, let's move him. I'll move him back. Oop, there you go. All right, yeah, so go ahead. You decide, and then we'll just sort of go through there, and we'll figure it out.
All right, so I basically have three choices. I can take the event, the faction op, and special activity, or the faction op only, mm-hmm. and no special activity, right?
Exactly.
So we're stuck in a monsoon, so this means that a lot of my stuff I can't do.
Yeah, you can't march or sweep. That's the things you can't do. Yeah. Well, you don't sweep. You're a guerrilla faction, but you can't march, essentially.
Oh, did I hide? There we go. What can I do? Let's see. I can rally.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. Where else have I got? Do I have stuff? So, my victory conditions, does it say what they are on here?
Yeah, it should. Let's see. The VC, is total opposition plus VC bases exceeds 35.
35, so I want to get to 35, so.
And you currently have 23.
Oh, yeah.
And opposition, just for people to know, each little province here, little areas, has a little number, one or two. And when you build support or opposition, that's how you get those points. So, like, you can see here in Quang Duc, where you have a base and two guerrillas, you know, it says active opposed times two. So that means that this population is worth one in Quang Duc, but it's actually worth 2 points because you've moved it to active opposition. It's like the furthest it can be in opposition. And
so in is it Bin Toi?
Yeah.
Or Bin Toi, or however you
something
say
like
that.
Honestly, I'm so bad at this too. I was like, I don't know. Like this is definitely another interesting part of these games. You get to learn new words and vocab.
So there are people who are not Viet Cong in there.
Yes.
So is that just kind of opposition forces that happen to be in there at that time?
Yeah. So this game's we're doing the short game, and that's where it starts in like 1965. So this is roughly a situation that was probably around the beginning of 1965. So yeah, you see there in Bin Tui or whatever it is, there's two guerrillas and one VC base, but there's also two U.S. troops and one Arvin police unit.
All right. And I have 10 resources, so I have 10 game bucks to go and do stuff.
Yes, exactly. And just so people know, a lot of the actions you take cost resources, and a lot of this is sort of your economy in the game, and a lot of the guerrilla ones usually take one resource per action. A lot of the U.S. or Arvin stuff can cost three. They get more money, but their stuff costs more.
So I think I'm going to take first faction op and special activity.
Okay.
And I think that's what I do, right?
Yep.
Okay. And so this is the first faction event. That mean or first faction op. That means that the top part of that card goes, or is it the bottom part of the card?
Well, if you do first faction op plus special activity, then you're not taking any of the event. You're just going to pick operations and then some special activities to go with them.
Okay.
So I'll go to your sheet.
I was going to rally.
Okay.
I think.
Probably a good idea.
I wanted to put some guys in Bintoy.
So the thing is, you can only pick places that don't have support.
That don't have support.
Yeah, so the Bintoy is already has a low level of support. It's passive, so you can't rally there.
Okay.
You could rally anywhere else that just doesn't have support. That's the one restriction for the BC. They can choose any location, any province or city without support. They can rally there.
All right. So we'll put two guys, or what is it, one resource per space?
Yes.
And place one BC gorilla or place two with a base. We're going to put, do I just grab from here? I do. We're going to put it down in Kien Gang.
Kien Gang, yeah.
And that should cost me $1. Does it automatically take it?
No, that's one thing we'll have to keep track of automatically is our spending.
Okay, so decrease that to 9. And we'll put one in Tainan.
All right, yep. So I think you can actually get, let's see, you get one, let's see, a VC place. You can place up to the population plus bases if you have a base there. So in Tainan, you can actually put 3 gorillas in there for one resource.
Okay. Oh, really?
Yeah, that's the advantage. If you have a base there, then you count the population and the bases. So that's why they're really powerful in Tainan. Or like if you did it in Quang Duc, you could put 2 guys in Quang Duc because you have one population, one base.
We'll definitely put 3 in. What's this VC tunnel?
Oh, yeah. So that's one thing. So you'll see here that, I guess I didn't explain bases, but so the little flat circular pieces are bases, and these represent sort of your, you know, just like a base would, a logistical hub. Maybe it's where you have a lot of, you know, your headquarters, or you have a lot of ammunition, you know, the things you need to sustain fighting in an area. And the VC, of course, as was, you know, historic in Vietnam, they use extensive tunneling. And tunneled bases just get a marker, and what that means is it's much tougher for U.S. and Arvin to get rid of those bases. Normally, when you want to get rid of a base, you have to kill all the gorillas that protect it. You know, you got to get rid of all the things that protect that base, right? And then you can eliminate the base. But if it's tunneled, then when I try to eliminate the base, I have to roll a die. And 1 through 3, it stays tunneled. And if I roll like a 4 through 6, then I get rid of the tunneling, but the base remains. It just makes bases much tougher to crack and get rid of. Yeah, but the thing is, you can't place them unless an event comes up. It's not like you can just make a tunneled base. You have to actually take an event that gives you a tunneled base.
So I have a restriction on the number of guys in a particular province based on the population, which is this little white dot, or little white number.
That is, right? It's not a restriction like how many you can have. It's how many you could add if you have a base there. It's also like what the value of that area is worth. So like Tainan is worth 4 points for you because it's active opposition times 2, and it's already a 2 population area. So you get 4 points just for having that be, if that was your goal, I forget. You want opposition, yeah. You want opposition. So that for you is a valuable area.
Okay.
But yeah, there's no restriction on pieces. You can have like as many pieces as you can get into one area. I mean, you could, if you had all your pieces, and you can only have 2 bases per space, but you can have as many other pieces you want in there.
Yeah. All right. And so I can put 3 down there, and then I was going to put some in Quang Duc.
Okay.
So there's no, there's 1 base there, so I can put 2 more on?
Yes.
Is that right?
Totally.
Okay. All right. And that, I think, is all I'm going to do with my rally operation. Do I need to mark?
You you mean like what you're doing?
Yeah.
Well, you can do, there's a little thing with the pieces button up there. There's these black and white pawns. And the white ones are just like where you're doing regular stuff, just as a memory aid. And then the black ones are like where you want to do your special activity. So you don't really have to mark it. I mean, we're talking, this is good. They're really just a memory aid, basically.
Oh, okay.
So you've done that. I mean, the only thing is that costs you 3. So yeah. If we mark that, and then you can do special activity now. So you have a whole, you have tax, subvert, or ambush. And actually, you can't do ambush because you didn't march or attack. So that's so. Just so people know, you see here on the card. I'll zoom in on the card here. But you have insurgent operations and you have special activities, right? So the regular operations are your basic bread and butter stuff. You know, getting more guys on the board through rally, marching them around with that, attacking or conducting terror operations. And then your special activities are sort of your better abilities. But sometimes you have to do something like an operation to make an activity happen. So. You know, you did rally, but that means you can't do an ambush because the accompanying op for ambush is only march or attack, which sort of makes sense, right? Like, you have to either be moving or attacking before you can actually use this ambush. But since you did a rally, that means you could also do attacks or subvert.
Yeah, I think I'm going to try and do attacks.
Okay.
Just to each space, activate that VC gorilla, shift one level toward active support VC.
That sounds good. So you can do that in, let's see, yeah, so any up to 4 spaces with underground VC and no coin control.
Alright, so I got 1. So if I go for Kin Gang, Tay Nin, what's this one called? Coin Duck.
Oh, yeah.
And Kin Fong.
Perfect. So those will be your 4 spaces, and for each space, you activate a gorilla, you pick one to activate, you shift it one level towards support, and then you give the VC resources equal to twice the population, econ or twice the population. And econ is those little, are these little, what they call LOCs, or little roads you see that have like a, in between the provinces that have numbers on them. Population is that number in the country, and that little number on the LOC, that's econ.
Okay. So, all right, I've activated 4, right?
Yep.
And so that would basically add to my, is that opposed plus place? Plus
oh, wait, this is going to give you resources. So what we'll do, we'll give you your resources first, then we'll adjust opposition. So in Quang Duck, you get 2. In Tay Nin, you get 4 resources.
Okay.
So that's what, that's 6 right there. And then in Kien Fong, you get 4, and in Kin Gang, good 4. So, another 8. So that's pretty good. You've just made a lot of money.
So it should be a 21.
Yes. But because you're taxing people,
they're gonna be mad at me.
They're not so happy that you're just taking they're taking their money. So this is why it goes one level towards support. So what we'll do is, if you right click on on a any of those places and on the opposition button or the token there. Like here, I'll do this one in Quang Duck for you. So like, it just says adjust towards support. Boom.
So 22. Okay.
Right. And then every space you do that, you just shift it one level. So you already at like the max level on all those, and now it just shifts down, and then it automatically keeps track of that for you at the top.
Okay. So I may have hurt myself in the long run.
Well, I mean, it was a trade-off because honestly, you didn't have a lot of resources in the beginning. But 21 is a lot of resources for the VC. So you might have set yourself up now to really just have a lot of money and not worry about that.
All right. Well, I guess that's me.
All right. So perfect. Yeah, and everybody's been adjusted. Great. So now you've done everything you want to do with that. So you see, we go back to the Kent State card, and we see that basically you're up again because you're also playing the NBA. But because you did that op and special activity, you now can either choose to do a limited op, which means you can do any of your operations but only in one space, or you can choose to do the event, or you could pass and gain a resource.
What can the NBA do?
Let's see what they can do. So since you're just doing, you can't do anything special, so it's only just your regular operations. You can't march because it's a monsoon, but you can rally, attack, or conduct terror.
Okay. Yeah. Are there any lines of communication in a break?
You can't march though. That's the one thing.
Oh, that's true. That's true. All right.
That would be nice. That actually is helpful. And so the reason that's important to get on these lines of communication is during a coup round, if a guerrilla is sitting on a line of communication, it gets sabotaged. And if it's sabotaged, that means the government doesn't make any money off it. This is how Arvin makes money. They get aid, and they also get money off their internal economy, which is sort of what these LOCs represent. You know, it's like movement of goods and people, and it's the lifeline of the country, basically. So as guerrillas start taking those over, that takes away the kind of money that Arvin can make. But since it's Monsoon, and when we just started the first card, no one's moved on to an LOC, so that won't happen this round.
But, let's see, I can do Terror. Space with Envy and troops are underground guerrillas, one resource in each space. Toward neutral.
Right, because the NVA's victory goal is to establish control, and so they don't, you know, opposition's okay, but they really just want control. You know, like, having things opposition makes it tougher for, like, the U.S. and Arvin to do things, but really what the NVA cares about is projecting force and building up their infrastructure, right? Because their goal is to eventually just take over the South. And so the way they're, that's the way they do that. So for them, that's why they move towards neutral, because that way they can start sort of, if they get somewhere and the VC has got, you know, a ton of opposition, they can start reducing that opposition, you know, and saying, no, we're just going to make it neutral so the VC doesn't get an edge.
So I think what I'm going to do is in Quang Tri.
Okay.
Up north, I'm going to attack.
Oh, okay, nice.
And it says, remove one enemy per two NVA troops. But wait, I don't have NVA troops there, do I?
You have four guerrillas. So what would happen is, if you attack, all those guerrillas would go active, and then you roll a die, and if it's if it's equal to or less than the number, it's a six-sided die. So if it's equal to or less than the number of guerrillas you have there, you conducted a successful attack. If you rolled a 5 or a 6, then your attack would basically be ineffective.
Okay.
But since you, and normally that would be kind of dangerous, but since we're going to a coup round, and the thing about coup rounds is everybody that's active goes underground. You get kind of a reset. So that could be a free attack for you right there, for sure.
Alright, we're going to do that, I think. Let me activate all these guys. Ding. Surprise!
Surprise, we're out.
Alright, so how do I roll a die?
You can pick any of those colored buttons up there, and because if we were doing, so there you go, so you got it. So you can see there on the log, it says red, 4. That means you rolled a 4.
Yeah.
And actually, it even shows up at the top. That's interesting, that's nice. So what that means is your attack succeeded, and so you can now, let's see, what is it? I think you get to remove 2 pieces. 2 enemy pieces, bases last, and the U.S. took casualties. And since you're not attacking the U.S., if you attack U.S. forces and kill them, because the U.S. is just better trained and has better weapons, you have to lose a piece for every time you attack. But since you are attacking Arvin forces who are not well trained, not as well equipped, you can just take them off the board.
So just these two cubes or the two troops are the only thing that I can move. I can't also remove the base, right?
Not right now. Yeah, you only get to access 2 pieces. If next turn you come up and you attack, then yeah, that base is fair game.
Okay. Where?
I think you can just right click on it and it'll say return to available.
Alright.
Perfect, yeah, and that just automatically, now you can see that I've kind of got my stock up 2 because he's killed 2 of my guys in Quang Tri.
Okay. So I guess that's both of my guys.
All right, so normally what would happen is that you would now, actually moving down there. Normally that would be the end of that round, and what would happen is we would take these two guys and go to ineligible, and they would, the next card would come up, and then it would just be U.S. and Arvin, and we would decide what happens there. But what happened is now we got the coup card. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hit draw card, and I'm going to move the coup card over, because you can always see the next card up. That's always and that kind of can impact your strategy during the coup round. So this next round comes up, it's going to be Arvin and U.S. So what we do is we first look at the card, and in this game, unlike the other coin games just had basic propaganda rounds, which were just like victory point checks. This game is added a little wrinkle to it in the fact that Vietnam had a lot of different rulers who came in, or a lot of different people who ran the Saigon regime. And so this one represents, like, this guy, Nguyen Cao Cai. I do know that's Nguyen. That's the one thing I do know about Vietnamese names. That's Nguyen. So Nguyen Cao Cai has come into power. Now he's running the Saigon clique. And the effect that's now the new effect that's going to stay in for the rest of this round. Okay, so it says here, pacification costs 4 resources per terror or level. So pacification is the way that the U.S. and Arvin build support in the countryside. The U.S. can do it on their terms sometimes, but mainly during coup rounds is when you can engage in pacification. And all this means is this guy is really inefficient. He definitely is not about conducting pacification, so it costs you more money. Normally it costs you 3 resources to do a pacification shift, but now when he's in power, it costs you 4. So that's kind of a pain for my side, because obviously we don't want to spend a ton of Arvin's money, but that's going to make it more difficult. So what happens is we do a coup round, and this is where we stop and we kind of look at stuff and do resources. So if you come down here, they've made this nice little thing at the sequence of play at the bottom. We have a nice little track for the coup card. So we'll just start doing that. And the first thing up is victory. Does anybody have victory? Well, no.
No.
We just started, and if you look on the side of the board here, the track, here, let me zoom out a little bit. You'll see that there's a little shading thing. So the 51 is like the magic number for the U.S. and for Arvin. The U.S. has support plus available troops over 50, so if they have 51, that's their victory condition. And for the Arvin, it's coin control plus patronage. Well, as you can see, coin control plus patronage is 41, support plus available is 38, so we're not even close to victory on that for the U.S. or Arvin. And the same kind of goes here for the VC and NBA. VC needs over 35 opposition plus bases. They currently have 16. And the NBA needs over 18 NBA spaces they control plus bases. So nobody's close to victory right now. So there, no one won.
Yeah.
Next thing we do is this sabotage. Degrade trail, Arvin, NBA, VC casualties, and aid. So what happened, this means is basically if there were anybody on the LOCs, they would sabotage them, but no one's there. If the U.S. or Arvin had pieces in Laos and Cambodia, they could degrade the trail. So that's one thing I didn't really explain. Here's a little track on the side called the trail. And this represents sort of the NBA's Ho Chi Minh Trail. It's like their ability to use their logistical support in Laos and Cambodia and North Vietnam to move equipment and guys. You know, it's that there was that notorious thing that they could never really deal with, right? Because it was so difficult to disrupt NBA moving things in Laos and Cambodia. If you have like US guys or Arvin guys in here, during the coup round, you get to degrade the trail by 1 level. But that's not going to happen here either, because it's too early and nobody went over there. So we don't do that. Arvin, NBA, VC, casualties. We don't have any of those, so there's no casualties. None of that happens. So that's not a big deal. And because we had no casualties, aid stays the same. As you kill like U.S. people, the aid level goes down. And this sort of represents, you know, people less willing to give money, less willing to support a cause that increasingly seems hopeless. And so aid right now is 15. So it's not going to go down. It stays there, right? All right, so we go to the next one. Support. U.S. can pacify, then Arvin can pacify, and then the other people can agitate. So here's how this works. Pacification requires you to have troops. It requires you to have control, requires you to have troops, and a police queue. This is why police are important, because the sort of the idea of counterinsurgency is that you have to have stability and population control and also protection. And troops are really great at fighting. They're not really great at doing, like, civil actions and policing, you know? So the idea behind coin theory is that you secure the population with troops, but then you also secure, you know, legitimacy and governing by having a well-run police force who at least, you know, take over and help. So for the U.S., that means the only spaces where I see that I have control, troops, and a police cube is, like, Quang Tin up here, Binh Dinh, let's see, and also Binh Tui. Yeah, those are the places where I have all those that all, that don't automatically have like super support. Like you can see in Saigon, we have active support. So there's no reason for me to pass find Saigon. It's already like the most support it can get. But Bintui, Binden, and Kuangtin, those I could improve. Okay. But if you remember, we had that little, you know, it's win here. He makes it cost 4 for everything I want to do. So I need to be kind of, you know, kind of restrictive where I go because I don't want to spend a ton of money. So for me, I'm going to do pacification in, oh, I have to have control. So I don't have control in Bintui. I actually can't do it there. But I do have control in Kuangtin and Binden. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to spend 8 resources total. I'm going to spend 4 in Binden and move this up to active support. But that costs 4. So we're going to go down to 26. And then I'm also going to do it here in Kuangtin because I have the 2 troop cubes and 1 police guy. And I'm going to pay 4 there to move to passive. So now you can see on the side, I've jumped. Now all of a sudden my support and availability for the U.S. is 42. So, you know, I'm inching closer. So those are the 2 places I can do that. So what happens is you would have the U.S. chooses to do stuff, then the Arvin. Since I'm playing both sides, I just will make decisions for both of them. But if we had a multiplayer game, the U.S. would go first, then the Arvin could decide where they want to do this too. So now we go to agitate. And I believe that's only for the VC. I'm trying to remember. Let me pull out the rules here. Got my iPad with the rules loaded on it, so let's take a look here. Okay, 2 rounds. Oh, we got to add your, I forgot, we need to add your earnings for the aid. I forgot about this. So, this is where you get money during coup rounds. And for the Arvin, what you do is you add the economic value of LOCs that are not sabotaged. So, the total is 15, none of them are sabotaged, so Arvin actually gets 15 resources, so they'll actually jump up to 37.
My goodness.
I know, we can spend money. The VC gets money equal to the number of bases on the map. So you have 5 bases on the map, so VC gets 5. I'm going to move you up to 26. Let's see, NVA gets number of bases in Laos and Cambodia, plus 2 times the trail value. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you have 5 plus 2 times 2 is 4, so 9 resources. So they move up to 24.
Nice.
Yeah.
I was looking at these coup cards. I like that they are different coup cards.
Yes, like win is only going to come up once, but there's also like a failed coups that sometimes happen. And then there's also other leaders that you'll see that kind of have different impacts on the war for the U.S. and Arvin. Wynn is not a good leader. Like, he's a bad card. he's not great. I think there's another one that actually does better stuff for you. He is not a great leader, though. He's pretty awful. So, yeah, so we did the earnings. So let's go to agitate. Sorry, we skipped over earnings there, but now we'll do that. The VC can now spend resources to boost opposition in places with VC pieces and no coin control. So you get, and the way that works is you pay 1 resource per level shift and you can do 2 shifts of level. So actually you can go back now and restore all your opposition in those places that you just lost it. And then some.
I accidentally did a good thing.
You accidentally did a great job. And you can do that anywhere where there's no coin control and you have pieces. So there's lots of places. I mean, like, you could go to play coup and shift it over. And you can do it in Bintui. You have lots of options. And you have lots of money, which is very helpful. So it costs 1 per level you shift.
And I can only do it up to 2, right?
Yeah, you only get 2 level shifts. So if it was active support in some area, then you can only move it to neutral. But if it's, you know, at neutral, then you could move it all the way up to active opposition, right?
So, okay. So passive opposed. And so each one that I adjust toward opposition, that's what I want, right?
Yes, for VC, your goal is to just build opposition. You're trying to build the revolution.
So each of those, if I move 4, or was I limited to only 2?
you can do as many spaces as you want, but you can only shift each space two levels. That's what that means. Like, you could pick five places and shift each of them two spaces as long as you had money, right? That would cost you 10 resources. The max shifts are two, but the spaces are unlimited as long as you meet the requirement.
And it's no coin control, right?
No coin control and VC pieces. So even if it's just a base, but no coin control, you could do it, you know.
Okay. So in, is it Plaiku Darlak?
Mm-hmm.
I can adjust that torrid opposition?
Yes, you can. You can do two shifts. So this could go total active oppose for you right now.
Okay. And then that one. And this one is passive support down in Bin Tui.
Yes, exactly. You go to neutral, and then you can move it to passive passive opposition or whatever.
Passive opposition, yeah. All right, I think that's all of them. And so that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I'd lose six game bucks.
Yes, six game bucks goes away. But see, like that's why that doing the tax was not a bad idea, because honestly, the coup was coming up, you got a ton of money, and you were pretty much able to get that back and still have money. You know, like you did a good job there.
Where did my...
Oh, it's probably hiding under... Where did that money... There it is. It's probably just hiding.
Yeah, I can't get it. Oh, no. How do you get it?
Oh, double-click on it.
Double-click on it? Okay, it was on 26. There we go.
Yeah, when things are stacked, you double-click on it, and it'll, like, pull the stack out, and you can pick individual things out.
All right, so that should have been, $5. There we go.
And let me make sure. I don't think NVA gets to do this. No, NVA does not get to agitate. That's not what they're into. All right, so we did that. Now we do the redeploy. Let's take a look at that. Let me just keep the rules out to read this. Okay, redeploy means that we basically have to shift some forces around. So in Laos and Cambodia, we would remove all those pieces, but there's U.S. or ARVN pieces, but there are no U.S. or ARVN pieces in Cambodia or Laos. And actually, there's a penalty. If you're the U.S. and you get caught there, those pieces go out of play. It's considered like the political cost of having a war in a neutral country is losing those guys. ARVN people just go back to available. Like if you had a bunch of ARVN guys in there, they just go back to the pool of available troops. But if it's the U.S., you definitely get in big trouble.
So we're mostly just stuck abandoning those guys and disavowing that we knew anything about them?
Yeah, or essentially, like, you just, the cost of the people find out that you were doing it, and the political cost or the popular cost of just doing those kind of actions means that you just don't have as free hand. Like, you can't just keep sending guys in. So that's sort of the way they model that, because the U.S. has very limited troops, essentially, and you can only decide to pull them in or out during these coup rounds. That's when you kind of, you know, change the force level. Because the way the U.S. wins is it builds support, right? It's trying to build active support everywhere, and it's trying to pull all of its troops out. Like, you want to have as few troops in country as possible and a lot of support, and that's how you win the game for the U.S. And that can be tough to do.
Yeah.
So, yeah, like, if the U.S. pieces were out there, they go out of play if they get caught. So they actually have some guerrillas, which, you know, I haven't gotten to yet, but when I start using them, we'll talk about them. And actually, guerrillas are a little special. They don't get caught because they're actually just, like, they're local people we've trained or special forces, so it's kind of secret. But if we actually had troops over there, you know, each troop cube represents, I don't know, like a couple thousand guys or something. It's a lot of people, so it would be bad. So that happens there. But nobody's in Laos and Cambodia, so we're good. ARVN must move its troops from LOCs and provinces without coin bases to cities without NVA control, or to any bases or Saigon. So anywhere I have troops with no base, if I'm ARVN, which is, let's see, actually nowhere. Yeah, everybody's actually with a base or hanging out. This is kind of, so what happens in the game is, like, if I had ARVN, I had a bunch of guys somewhere without a base, like, let's say I had invaded, like, Quang Duc or something with, you know, 10 troop guys. During the coup round, all those troop guys have to go somewhere else. They can't just stay in country. They have to be at a base or go back to a city.
Okay.
Police always stay. That's why it's really key to have police in places, because police never have to leave an area they stay in. They can actually stay there and keep going. That's why police are difficult sometimes to get in places, but they're the most powerful and sustaining, because they can actually stay there in between rounds, and that does become more important later. And then... So then I can also readjust my forces. ARVN can move police to any LOCs or coin control spaces. The U.S. can do whatever it wants. It doesn't have to redeploy. You know, it has the staying power to stay anywhere. So what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to take one of these police out of Saigon. I'm going to take a police out of Saigon and a police out of this southern city. Was it? What are you? You are Kanto. So I'm going to take one out of Saigon and Kanto, and I'm going to put that one, the one guy from Saigon, I'm going to move this police guy. He's going to go to An Lok. And then I'm going to take another guy from Kanto, and I'm going to move him all the way up to Hue, the city in the north. The reason I'm doing that is because the south has a lot of guerrillas, but I also have a lot of troops and cubes down there. The north is kind of where I don't have a lot of forces right now, especially since you killed my guys in Quang Tri. And so I need to start bulking up, you know, trying to at least put some guys up there to make it a little tougher to take. And now the NVA, you may move troops if you want from any map space to any place in the NVA base.
Okay.
So that is, you don't have to, but you can. And that's the thing you can do. So you have troops up in North Vietnam, you have some in Southern Laos. They can go to any space that you have an NVA base in right now.
All right. Let's see. And you said that's troops, so the squares, not the gorillas?
Right, yeah, just the cube guys, the squares. The squares.
Right. Let's see, North Vietnam seems pretty secure.
Right, another thing about North Vietnam is that the U.S. and Arvin cannot go into North Vietnam. So it's going to always be like a safe place for you to be. Like that's because the idea they said is that basically that the U.S. didn't want to piss off China. And if they'd have gone in North Vietnam, that would have pissed off China, and China probably would have gotten involved.
Yeah. All right. With a base, you said.
Mm-hmm.
As the NVA, can I invade cities?
Yes.
Like, can I just move my troops in there?
Well, when you get to move, you can. The NVA can move anywhere. For this redeploy, it has to just be a place you have a base. So if you had a base in a city, then yeah, you'd be able to put all your guys in there. Like right now, you could put all your troops into Quang Tri, you know, or you could do that. Or you could move them all down to like the Fishhook or the Parrot's Beak.
Yeah, that's actually, I'm going to move them all down to the Fishhook. All
right.
I'm going to move, let's see, these guys. The Fishhook.
Nice.
And I think that's pretty much all I'm going to do for right now.
Okay, that sounds good.
Yeah.
So this is not the final rounds. We don't have a game end thing. Now we go to the commitment phase. This is where I decide as a U.S. player, do I want to bring more troops into Vietnam? You know, like, am I, looking at the situation, do I think I need more U.S. cubes? Let's see. Make sure I'm reading this all right. I may move up to 10 U.S. troops in two bases among the available box, which is over here where I have my little troops and my base guys. I can move 10 troops or two bases between the available box, any coin-controlled space, LOCs, or Saigon. So I'm going to bring troops in because the U.S. does not have a lot of people right now. So I can pick any coin-controlled space, LOC, or Saigon, and we're going to go into Hue. Because I feel like this is going to get overrun really quick. And I think maybe we'll do some Quang Non. So what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to pull out four troop cubes. And the way you can do multiple is like right-clicking on it, and it'll be like, how many do you want to grab? And then you put a number, and then you can just drag that over, like right there. So like I just dragged four guys. And I'll sort of separate them out here. So I'll put four there, and you'll notice now my support went down by four because I took four troops out.
Okay.
And then I'm also going to put, we're just going to go big here. I'm going to put four more in Quang Nam.
This seems like Obama's surge troops.
Yeah, and so you've played a distant plane, and like a distant plane, that's like a special activity you can do is surge, right? You can surge guys in and out. In this one, you know, the way they justify designers are sort of like this was an era where U.S. policy was slow, you know, escalation was slow, de-escalation was slow. So there wasn't that sort of idea of like bring in 40,000 guys and let's just do it, you know. It definitely was more of that like let's reevaluate after a year. And I think each coup card represents like a year or something. You know, it's like reevaluating the policy. So you don't get to just surge in and out. You really have to decide here, you know, am I bringing guys in? Am I taking them out? All right, so that's what I'll do. I'll just put those guys there. And then, let's see, we're in the reset phase. So if the trail's at 0, improve it to 1. Nope. And if it's at 4, move it to 3. Trail is good. Remove all terror and sabotage. We don't have any of those. Flip all guerrillas and special forces underground. So what we can do here is there's actually a button up here called the reset. You see that little button up there that says reset phase?
Yeah.
Well, we hit that, and then it does it automatically for us. Everybody goes underground. Everything would be changed. All those sabotaged. I mean, that's really nice to do this here. So it's super automated.
That is nice.
Oh, yeah. It's great. So we'll do that. I'll also hit this end faction because it gets rid of all the movement trails there. And now everybody goes eligible. So everybody gets to come back over here. And we start play on the next card. So then I hit draw. So now you can see, oh, there it is, Melee. So we got this card's coming up, the MACV, and then Melee will be next. So it looks like Arvin and US are up, so I get to go. So I'll move this coup card back to here. Okay. So now I get a turn. Normally, that took a while because coup cards, you know, the first time you run through it, it takes a little bit, and it is kind of the big, like, upkeep phase, you know, doing all that stuff. So because that came so soon, that means this next round is probably going to be longer because we have more cards to get through to get to the next coup card.
Yeah.
So that's the one thing that'll happen. That happens occasionally. It works out, though. What usually happens is you get a lot of money, and then you have to wisely spend that money over a much longer campaign. Okay, so this card is up, MACV, the Military Assistance Command. Let's see, the event, this doesn't have an unshaded event. This is just pure, or it doesn't have a shaded one, it's just unshaded. And it says either US and then Arvin or NVA, then BC, each executes any one free special activity. The faction executing the event stays eligible. So if I pick...
powerful card.
That is pretty good. It lets me do one free special activity, and US, then Arvin can do it. Oh man, I actually might take that because it'll let me stay eligible.
Yeah.
So what'll happen is, yeah, exactly. So oh hey Ubi, hold on a second. I'll talk to you in just a second. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna say event. I'm gonna put him just to like halfway on the event because he's actually gonna stay eligible. And so what we'll do is we'll take that. This is especially powerful for me because not only do I get to do this free stuff, but the next player up is the U.S. So, like, I'll get to do... Because if you see on the sequence of play, I took the events. The next person gets to do an op and special activity. So this is going to be, like, a nice little 1-2 whammy for me. All right, so the U.S. and then Arvin each executes one free special activity. So let's take a look at the U.S. special activities. I can advise, I can airlift, or I can airstrike. Airstrike is pretty potent, lets you target up to 6 spaces. And you have to have a piece in that space, like I have to have a U.S. or Arvin piece, but if I do, then I can just start bombing bad guys there. But bombing bad guys means I kind of drum up, you know, opposition to U.S. policy, because, you know, airstrikes in the Vietnam War were pretty brutal, a lot of massed air power, and it's really hard to have, like, you know, this is jungle warfare, so it was very tough to just, you know, it wasn't like they had stationary tanks or anything. It definitely was a very different kind of war. So you can imagine like how drone strikes work today. I mean, same idea, right? Much more controlled, but same idea. It's almost indiscriminate sometimes, so it just happens. So airstrikes are potent, but they build up opposition. And honestly, I'm looking at the map, and there's a couple of places I could airstrike. Like, I could definitely... Well, actually, I can't. There's actually no guys... Like, because remember, I can only airstrike exposed guerrillas. So there's no exposed guerrillas anywhere, and the NVA has not made a move into the country, so I don't have anybody I can target. So there's really nowhere to airstrike, so I won't airstrike. I can airlift, which lets me any 4 spaces. I can redistribute troops and up to 4 irregulars, rangers, or Arvins among those spaces. It's just like a big, quick moving thing. I can take guys and move around quickly. And I can pick any space. And then there's advise. And advise says, in each space, I can sweep or in place assault with Arvin. So this is just a way to get Arvin to do stuff for free. Like, it's like me basically being like, Arvin, you know, get your act together. It's time to sweep, it's time to do this. And I can also add some aid or do some ranger stuff, which is not bad. I think, looking at the map here, there's some guys in Binh Dinh. There's probably some guys in Quang Nam. Quang Tri is kind of getting crazy. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to airlift. And what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to bring the noise and ruckus, as I say. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull my little white pieces out here. I'm going to airlift out of Hue. I'm going to airlift out of Quang Nam and Da Nang. And the spot I'm going to go to is Quang Tri.
Oh, man.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take all my troop cubes out of there, and we're going to all flood into Quang Tri.
No, the last bastion of beautiful communism.
Beautiful, beautiful communism. So as you can see here, as I'm moving guys in, I've just started taking control because I've moved in so many guys. And that's nice that it just automatically keeps track of that. I mean, control is not necessarily what I want. That's what the Arvin wants. But, you know, that's just the consequence of having more guys in that area. You know, that's how it works. So that's his special activity. So we'll go ahead and end those movement trails. And now the card says Arvin can do one special activity. So they get to choose to govern. This is how you build patronage in the game. I could build aid, but this is how you get your special ability with Arvin, is through governing. I could transport, which is kind of like a weaker version of airlift. It does let me move Arvin guys pretty easily. Or I can raid. And raid lets me move rangers, and then those are their little cylinder guys, their little gorilla looking guys that are yellow. It lets me move them and then use them to kill bad guys. So the thing I'm going to do is I'm going to actually use raid. And in each space, I can move in any adjacent ranger as desired. Then, if desired, I can activate an underground ranger to remove two pieces. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to select Ben Tui. I'm going to move this ranger from Saigon. He's going to come into Ben Tui. He's going to activate. And he's going to kill those two gorillas there.
Oh, no.
My special guys. So we're going to return you there and return there. All right. And so that's... So there we go. That is the event there for Arvin. So that was their little special thing. And we'll keep them aside because that's how you know that the next thing is what the next option has to be for the U.S. So the U.S. has to take a second faction op. I mean, I could pass, but I'm going to take advantage of this. So again, op plus special. So now you can see that I've set myself up very nicely here to do something in Quang Tri. Although you have a bunch of gorillas there. So what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to sweep, and then we might do some airstrikes. So what we'll do is we'll sweep. We pick a couple places we want to sweep in. And if it's just U.S. pieces for me, it's free, because the U.S. doesn't really have resources in this game. So, you know, the U.S. is supposed to have like a great economy, you know, whatever. It doesn't necessarily have to do those things or pay for things. If I was going to use Arvin troops, or like, because you can tell Arvin to do stuff, you got to spend Arvin money for that, you know, to have them do things. But if U.S. does something on its own, it's pretty much free. So I'm going to sweep in Bin Din. I'm going to sweep in Quang Tri. And then honestly, is there anywhere else I can sweep? Let's take a look at sweep real quick. It says, move any troops into an area if you want, and then to adjacent spaces. Activate one gorilla per U.S. troop or regular there. But if I'm in the jungle, then I get to activate one enemy piece for every two, because it's harder to find guys in the jungle. So I killed everybody I'm into. I don't want to do this. So what? Oh, okay, here's what we're going to do. We're going to take the three U.S. troops out of Kanto, and I'm going to sweep into Qianfeng. That's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to bring those three guys up there.
Not liking any of this.
I know, the U.S. is getting active here. And I'm going to expose those guys there. I'm going to activate the guys in Qianfeng, because I found you. And I'm also going to do that in Bin Din. And then my last place will be here in Quang Tri to expose those guys. So sweep is the primary way that you get your guys moving and also exposing gorillas, right? That's the way you, that's the basic way you get guys around the board, except for transport. You know, this is the way you can move very short distances. You can either move like an adjacent space, or I could have hitched a ride on one of these roads and gone to an adjacent space to one of the roads, you know. But I can't just take guys from like Quang Tri necessarily and move them all the way down to like Saigon, you know. You have to use transport or airlift for that, because that's a bigger distance. All right, so I've swept, and then I'm going to pick a special activity, and I'm going to use... So because I did sweep, I can't do advise. You see how it says accompanying op, train, or patrol. So I can't advise, but I could airlift or airstrike. And I'm going to airstrike. So airstrike, what does it do? It says 1 to 6 spaces with coin pieces, only 2 in monsoon. And in those spaces, I can remove a total up to 6 enemy pieces. And every time I bomb a space, I have to shift it to opposition because, again, it's just kind of this crazy bombing campaign. And if I want, I can degrade the trail 1 box. But the one thing we didn't really talk about is at the beginning of this game, because we did the short one, the NVA already has this special ability built in. And so that special ability is basically to have a lot of anti-aircraft guns protecting key parts of the trail. And so my airstrike can only reduce the trail to level 2. And it's already at level 2. So I can't use airstrike to get the trail any lower, you know. That's sort of the one thing about airstrike. It lets you actually hurt the trail. It sort of represents bombing missions into North Vietnam, bombing missions into Laos and Cambodia to disrupt, you know, movement of stuff. But since you have anti-aircraft guns, I can't reduce it beyond 2. So 2 is where it's always going to stay, basically. So the place I'm going to launch my airstrike, though, is going to be Quang Tri. And we're going to do it in Kien Phong because it's already totally opposed against me, so more bombing there won't make any difference.
They already hate me.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to spend 5 of my 6, you know, bomb targets, right? I'm going to use that to eliminate everybody in Quang Tri, like, because I've exposed all the guerrillas there, and there's a base. So that's 5 pieces. So I'm just going to return them to available. And I would normally mark this 1 level towards oppose, but it's already at the most oppose it can be. So that's sort of like a freebie for me in a sense. And then I have 1 target left, and I'm going to use that to get rid of 1 guy in Kien Phong. So there, he'll go there. And so that's the end of my events there. So I'm going to hit this end faction button to get rid of all the movement trails. And what will happen is that normally, you know, Arvin and US will both be ineligible, but because of the event I took as Arvin, they actually stay eligible. We'll go back over here. And that's the end of that card. So now we'll hit the next draw card. All right, you're up.
Man, we just kind of started out with some intense activity.
Yeah, that's the one thing about this game, because it's more modeling a war. It's definitely a lot more. I mean, if you've played a distant plane in other games, a lot of the coin games, I mean, you attack and stuff, but a lot of it is like just positioning forces. There's a few battles sometimes. There's a lot of ambushes. I mean, here you're definitely going to get a lot of contact. You know, it's going to be a lot of like boom, boom, boom. And it looks like I did bring in overwhelming force in Quang Tri, but, you know, I also exposed a bunch of troops there, right? And there are different things you can do to attack them. Like the NVA has a bombard special ability that lets them sort of launch, you know, mortars essentially or things into other areas. And you could also do ambush. Like ambush is great in this game because you can get on an LOC and then attack an adjacent space, which is new in this game. That's actually a really devastating ability. You can just march on something for free because marching onto LOCs costs nothing. And then you can launch an ambush and kill a guy in an adjacent space. So even though it looks, you know, I brought a lot of guys out, but, you know, as the U.S., I don't want to lose guys, because if I lose a bunch of guys, you know, that hurts aid. It also hurts my ability to have total amount of troops.
Alright.
So, yeah. I've kind of put the pressure on you here, but now it's, but that's just because I got a very fortuitous card there. That was actually really powerful to have that ability. That's normally would not be so fast. It would take me a couple turns to sweep and then do all that stuff.
Eight minus 6. All right. So, wait, is the U.S. is still eligible as well, right?
No, the U.S. actually is done. Only the Arvin that took that event gets to stay eligible. The executing faction stays eligible.
So, for my lie, taking it, since the Viet Cong has the first I would basically get to set a province with U.S. troops to active opposition. The VC place a base and guerrilla there.
And a, yeah, minus six.
A minus six. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, that's a pretty powerful ability. You can definitely, I think it was, say, active opposition. Yeah, so, like, any place I already have even active support, you can immediately drive it down straight to active opposition, which is really powerful.
So, if I wanted to, I could take Saigon?
Yeah, you can totally pick Saigon and drive it straight down to active opposition, get a guerrilla and a base there. And that sort of represents, like, My Lai was like, it's just really pissing people off in Vietnam.
Yeah.
And they're not real happy. That's why it's a really powerful event and card.
Alright. So, eligible factions. Me, I'm going to do... I'm going to do it. First faction op plus special... First faction event.
Okay.
And we're going to do, we're going to put a base and a gorilla.
Okay.
In Saigon.
All right. That's actually, I forgot to flip those guys over when I murdered them. So we'll go ahead and flip them underground. There we go.
okay.
Yeah, when you return guys, it doesn't automatically flip them, and they automatically come in underground.
And so this moves to active opposition.
Yeah, go ahead and shift that down. It should automatically count that stuff up there. So yeah, that's hurt U.S. even more. You can see now we're down to 21 support plus availability because Saigon is sort of the linchpin.
Yeah, and then I'm down to 15, right?
Oh, so that didn't cost you any money.
Oh, that's right. Oh, it's aid.
Yeah, aid will go down, but that's a free thing for you.
Yeah, so aid to 9. Oh, wait, is there two things there?
Oh, there is. It's cool. I got the econ button. We'll move it to 15. Yeah, boom.
There we go.
All
right. So, yeah. First faction event.
All right, perfect. So, yeah, now you've done that. So now we look at the card, and the next up will be Arvin, because they have the yellow one. And since I stayed eligible, that means I get to go here. But I can't choose the event, because you've already done the event.
Yeah.
So the only thing I have left is op plus special activity, or I could pass. But I'm going to take the op and special activity. See, this is good. Now we've kind of broken up the rhythm. Sometimes you get that rhythm where it's like two good guys go, then two bad guys go, then two good guys go, you know, whatever. Now we've kind of broken it up a little bit. So this will start really putting interesting spin on the cards that come up on the faction order. So I'm Arvin. Now I get to do an op and special activity. I'm going to train. So that's going to be my op. I need to get some guys on the board. You've done a good job killing guys, so I need to start putting guys on the board. So train, as we look here, it says I can pick cities or provinces without NVA control. That's my only restriction. Cost me 3 per space. And if it's a city or US Arvin base, I can place rangers or up to 6 cubes. So I have to pick a city or a place with a base, and that's kind of the other thing. I need to pick a place without NVA control and a place that is a city or just a US base. So I'm going to choose, where should I go? Oh, I can pick U.S. base or my base. Let me take a look at that. If in a city, U.S. or Arvin base. Okay, I'm going to pick Pleiku as one place I'm going to train. Just mark that there. And I'm also going to put a guy in, I'm going to go train in Kanto. So that's going to cost me 6 resources. Where am I? Oh yeah, I'm 37. So I'm at 31 now. And I'm going to put, I could put out either 1 to 2 rangers, which are their little, those little guys I just moved around earlier, right? But all my rangers are on the board, I think, right now. Or I can put up to 6 cubes. So I'm going to put 6, let's see, I only have 10. So I'm going to put 4 troop cubes into, what is this place called? Pleiku. So here comes 4 guys. Boom. I'll also put in 2 police. So that'll be my 6 I put there.
Quang Tri, I remember when we were happy friends.
And then on in Kanto, I'm gonna put just 6 troop cubes. All my remaining troops. We're gonna go into Kanto.
Where is Kanto?
It's down. It's on the left of Saigon. Yeah. And then because I trained, and I could pacify if it's Arvin troops, police, and coin control. I can pacify 1 to 2 levels. Oh, I probably should have done that in. I take that back. Instead of Kanto, I'm gonna do this in Saigon because actually I need to start pacifying there. So I'm gonna move those 6 guys over there into Saigon. And ugh, see, this is where having that win guy is gonna hurt me because it costs 4 resources to shift instead of 3. So I am gonna actually spend. I'm only gonna spend 4. We're gonna move you down to passive support. Or passive opposition. So I'm gonna spend 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so now I can do a special activity, and because I did train, I can do govern or transport, because you can't do a raid. You can only do patrol, sweep, and assault with raid. So with govern, I can obtain, let's say, I can in 1 or 2 point control spaces with support, and it's not Saigon, and not selected for training, I can either add 3 times the population to my aid, or if I have more Arbin cubes than US cubes, I can transfer just the population value to patronage and shift it towards neutral, 1 level to neutral. So I can do that in 2 spaces, and I think I'm going to do that, because I don't really want to move guys around. I'm just going to use govern. So 1 to 2 spaces that are coin controlled, that's not Saigon, and I didn't select for training. That's going to be play coup. I'm going to pick play coup as 1. And where else do I have more guys than you? That's not Saigon. And, I'm going to pick Hue. So those are my 2 spaces for govern. So govern says I can either add 3 times the population to my aid, or if I have more cubes than you, I can do 1 time and add to patronage and then shift it 1 level towards neutral. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to do... I'm going to use play coup. I'm going to govern and play coup and just get aid. So I'm going to take 3 times the population value there. And we're going to move it. That's going to give me, what, 3 resources on aid?
I think so.
1, 2, 3. Got to start rebuilding that aid. But in way, I'm actually going to do patronage. And it's already at neutral, so I can't shift it anywhere else. And I get 2 points on my patronage. Boom. And that's, so you can see I'm sort of, I'm getting close here. If you look down here at my victory condition, since we're playing 2v2, I actually have to win with both guys, and that's how it works for both sides. You have to win with both. So I'm getting close to victory here for my Arvin forces, right? I have 49 coin control and patronage total. So they're moving on up. All right, so that'll be what I do there, and that'll be all my stuff. So we'll say end faction play, and time for a new card. Let me actually move these guys over. So both Arvin and the VC are going eligible, and then the US becomes eligible now. And we do new card.
And this is a huge NBA card, it looks like.
Yeah, MIGs. So the other thing is, you see where it says NBA capability. So in this game, I think every side has the ability to get capabilities, I think. Maybe not. Yeah, I think everybody has their own. Capabilities are like power-ups, bonuses that you can get that stay with you the entire game. There's another kind of power-up called a momentum, and it only lasts for like a coup round. So between 2 coup cards, you get that ability. So MIGs here is a capability for the NBA. If you took it, it says unless the shaded Top Gun or unshaded Top Gun, which is its own event and it's not out yet, whenever airstrike degrades a trail, you remove 1 available troop to casualties. That's very powerful. So like available troops are the guys over here that I draw from in the coup rounds, but if you take that event and then I conduct airstrike, or if I degrade the trail, then you automatically can take 1 of these guys and just put them straight in the casualties box, which hurts aid, and also if there's enough in there, I start losing guys permanently.
Okay. So, I guess since I would be as silly not to. I definitely want to take the event.
Well, here's the one thing. Like, that is really good. But the problem is, like, unless you start building the trail up a lot, so the only way you can build up the trail as NBA is when you rally. You can also pay two more to boost the trail up one level. I can never degrade it past two. You know, like, it's always going to stay at two because you have that AAA capability already.
Okay.
So, I mean, if you build it up, I mean, that will hurt. I will want to knock the trail down. But I won't. I can't knock it down past two. Like, if that AAA wasn't there, I would totally be trying to knock it down to zero all the time. So it's a hedge thing. You could take it, and then it would be just even more painful for me to do anything. Or
I'm gonna go for an operation and an event then.
Okay.
Or an operation and activity.
Yeah. This will probably give you the, now you can spend some of that money you made.
Yes. So I have a question.
Yeah.
I want March. I think March.
Okay.
Move enemy any spaces. Move one enemy. Can I march all of the troops from Fishhook into Anlock?
Yes, you can. That counts as adjacent. I think you don't have any. Let me make sure. Yep. NBA troops grows into adjacent spaces. It does have support, but since you're not moving guerrillas, the one thing about moving guys is that the area you move into has support, and you move like. So the basic formula is three. Like since I had two troops guys there, you could move like one guerrilla in and have him not be detected. But if you had moved two gorillas in, they both would go active because that number plus the number of cubes already there is more than three. But troop guys don't ever go active. You know, they're just always there. So by moving that in, you know, you don't have to worry about that rule at all. They just show up.
And so this counts as a move, not an attack, right?
Right, that is a move. That's a march.
Okay. So march, and it's one resource per non-LOC destination?
Yes. So, like, for example, if you had guys in the Fishhook and Fuklong, you wanted to move into Anlok, you would just pay one resource, and then you could move any guys that are adjacent into Anlok, and that would just cost one resource. And so it's not like you paid two to move guys from Fuklong and Fishhook. It's all about destination space.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So it would just, I would go down one.
Exactly.
Am I reading it right?
Okay. Yep.
All right, so we're in Anlok. Should I move a gorilla in there? I don't know.
You can move a gorilla in there. That wouldn't hurt. You can also move him anywhere else. I mean, he could move into Play Coup for free, or not for free, but not be detected because there's opposition there. So, like, it doesn't even matter how many cubes I have there. It's already got opposition. So you sort of, you know, like, the people cover for you as you move in. But if it's support, then you got to kind of do that math and be like, can I get guys in without them being detected?
Well, I'm actually going to move. Can I move this guy in Quang Duc into Fong Luk?
Fong Luang. All right, hold on. Quang Duc. Let me find that. I have to remember where all these places are again.
Yeah, I know.
So you want to. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you can move that guy.
All right. We'll go for NBA control. And move one. I don't know if it's worth it. Is there a way for you to get to me easily?
It's hard for me to get into the Fishhook in Cambodia. I mean, I can, but I have to judge if I'm going to get caught there or not. You can move for free to LOCs, and that lets you take away that money during a coup round, and you can also conduct ambushes into adjacent spaces from an LOC.
Yeah. So I think we're going to move the Southern Laos troops.
All right.
To this LOC.
Sure.
Where do those go? Do they go to this black dot, or do they go to just on the yellow line, sort of?
They go, so what it'll be is it'll just be that either that Route 14 or that other Route 14. There's a zero Route 14, and there's that one value Route 14. You could pick either one of those to jump onto.
Alright.
Oh. You can move on, and you can split your forces and move two to each, or put one on you, and those are free movements, because moving on to an LOC is free.
Why don't I see? Where are you seeing Route 14?
Oh, I'm sorry. It's like, you see like what looks like a little highway road from that black dot next to Southern Laos, that Dakto black dot. And if you look below, it's got a little road thing. That's Route 14.
Route 14. Okay.
Yeah, they actually labeled them in this game, which is really nice, because sometimes you're like, that LOC, that's, you know, here, but now they actually have names.
So we're going to move on to this one.
All right.
Be crowded up on there.
Yeah, it's okay.
Alright, so I think, and that doesn't cost me anything, right?
Not to move to an LOC. It's free to go there.
Alright, so I think that my troop movement from Kwangduk to Fuakwang costs another one.
Yes.
Alright, so I should be at 22. And that should be it for that one.
That's your march. So now you get to do a special activity.
Yeah. So really, there's nothing I can... I can infiltrate? Let's see.
You can infiltrate? Yes. Any place with an MVA base. Infiltrate lets you build up troops really quickly, or it lets you take over VC stuff. Like, if you had more... If you had a place where you had more guys than VC, then you can start taking over their stuff. Like, you can take over their troops or their guerrillas and make them your own, or you can take over their bases, things like that.
I think I'm going to bombard...
Okay, yeah, that's a good one.
And I'm going to bombard, I think, Quang Tree and Saigon? Can I bomb my own people?
So wait, the way that'll work, so the thing is you have to have, you can bomb places, but it has to be adjacent to a space with at least three troops.
Okay.
So like you could, like you can, that route you have, you could bomb Bin Din, Pleiku or Khantoum, you can bombard there. Because those are considered adjacent spaces.
Alright, we'll say Bin Din and Pleiku.
And you can, and actually you can pick two. You get two spaces that you can pick.
Yeah.
And then you get to remove, I believe, one troop. Let's see, yeah. It's like either... Yep, remove one Arvin or U.S. troop cube to the... to either casualties or to return. So you probably are going to pick on the U.S. because that's honestly like how you start reducing aid. And like, for every three guys that die, one is permanently removed during a coup round. So as you start accumulating more casualties, I'll start losing guys.
Yeah. So basically it's send one to casualties?
Mm-hmm. So yeah, you pick whichever two spaces. You get two spaces.
Yeah. I'm going to go for this.
Perfect. Yeah, so Bin Din and play coup. Yeah, perfect.
All right. And I think... that's it for that particular faction.
Yes. Okay, so now it's me. And, or it's the U.S., I should say. So I get to do either a limited op, or the event, or I can pass. Passing doesn't look really attractive for me, because the next card, I don't really, don't come up at all until the very end. The event is kind of interesting here. You know, NVA minus six during each reset resources, which is not bad.
Yeah.
But honestly, like, I need to do stuff with the U.S. So let's go ahead and do a limited op. And what I'm going to do with my limited op here is I'm going to actually assault and Bin Din.
Okay.
And so what that does is that normally this is the Highlands, so I would have to have two guys to kill one, because it's, you know, defensive terrain, so it's easier for the defender to hold out. But because I have a base there, U.S. gets to be more efficient because they have a base, and they get to do one for one anywhere they have a base.
Okay.
Let me double check on that, because I know that's their thing, yeah. In each space, remove one active enemy piece, troops, then guerrillas, bases last, tunnels on 4-6. For each U.S. troops cube, right? And it's two for one if there's a U.S. base. Oh, I get to two guys for one guy if there's a base. Or only one for every two if there's a Highland without a base. Which just basically means, like, without a base, that you'd have to have twice as many guys as you kill. That's what it means. So, like, in this game, sweeping requires more guys in jungle. Like, it requires a 2-to-1 advantage in jungle to sweep. But then assaults in Highland cost 2-to-1. That's sort of the weird 2-to-1. Numbers. So like attacking in the Highlands, you have to have more than double if you want, unless you have a base. And if you're sweeping, you gotta have more than double if you want to uncover everybody. So what I'll do is I'll attack and Bin Din and eliminate the residual VC presence there. So I'll go ahead and mark return available. I'm gonna go ahead and flip these guys over before I return them, because that just makes it easier.
It's interesting that it keeps track of that.
Yeah. They did a good job. I mean, yeah, Joel has gotten, who programmed this or did pretty much all the stuff behind the scenes on this. This is definitely the best one he's made so far, and it's super automated, and it works very well. So that actually is great. Because otherwise you'd have to like drag everything over and put it in the right space, make sure they don't like stack, you know? Because like you can see when I return that base, it automatically put it in the sixth spot, you know?
Yeah.
So you know you have five left. That's actually super great. So that was the one. So because I had to go second, because you did the special op and activity, I could only pick one space to do one thing. So that was it. I picked Bindin. It didn't cost me anything. The U.S. assaulted. I could have paid money to have Arvin do a follow-up assault in that space, but I killed everybody. So that didn't have to do that. So that turns over. So we mark VC and Arvin eligible, and NBA and U.S. ineligible. And draw a card. All right, so Arvin comes up first here. So the event is General Lansdale. And I can set a space outside Saigon with U.S. or Arvin to active support, add a terror marker there, and patronage plus one. Or the nasty event is no U.S. assault until the coup round, which would actually not be so great. And you would come up next, right? Because it's actually the VC would come up next.
Yeah.
And that still would be very good. So what I think is, I don't want to give you access to this event. I don't want you to take it at all. So because
you're
of
take the event for no reason, for just to keep me away.
Just to do it. So the way I keep you from taking the event is I do this first thing. I do an op only, but no special activity. So I come up here, and this means I can't do as much, but it also means that when you come up, you only can either pass or take a limited operation. You can't even take the event. So I've made the event not on the table at all. And that's really why I like the system they have here with the factions and the decisions, because, you know, that's rough. I didn't want you to take it, but, you know, that also means I can't do more fun stuff on my turn, right? Like, I'm more limited, but I'm also limiting what you could do.
So on the cards, there's 1968, 1965. Mm-hmm. Does this have an impact in different types of games that you play?
So we put together a short deck. Like, you can see those little buttons there. It say short game, medium, and full. What's interesting in this coin game, as opposed to the other ones, is that because this is a well-recognized historical event in the past, you know, a lot of things are easily periodized, right? So you have sort of the early Vietnam War, the mid, and then the escalation, and then sort of the late game. So what they did in this one is that they actually divide the cards into their sort of historical eras, right? The three periods. And if you did a short game, you can just do it with just events that happened between 1965 and like 67 and 68, or like 65. So yeah, you would only get like period events. That's a way to sort of get more of the historical flavor of the game without really tracking you, but only seeing events that would only have happened in that period of the war. So like, you know, Lansdale here, he's marked, 1965, so he's really early, you know.
Yeah.
You would get him in almost all the games, right? But there might be some events like this bombing pause that's coming up. It's a 68 event. Like, if we had made the short game deck, that card would never have been put in, because it's a 68 card. And that represents, like, the time that they actually kind of were holding off to see if they could maybe get peace, or I forget what exactly the point was, but that's how that works. So that's a new thing they've done in this game, is that you can make a short game and do all the cards, or you can be like, no, I want to see the actual kind of events that happened during that period. And then if you do a medium game, you get all the way up to 72, and then the full game has just way, way more cards up to 72. So let's see. But that's what the numbers mean. We just did a short game with all the cards, so you can start seeing a lot of the cards that come up.
Yeah.
Because some of the later events do get kind of powerful and can do different things, and it really does change the way the war runs. You know, if you're only playing with a short deck, you know, or the up to 1967 events or whatever, yeah, you get a lot of different stuff that you wouldn't necessarily get by playing the full one. So I'm going to do, let's see, just an op, no special activity. So I'm the Arvin, that means I can't do it in my govern, so I can't really build stuff up, but I could do a train, a patrol, a sweep, or an assault. And I think it's time to start grabbing more territory. Let's see what I can do here. I moved a bunch of guys here and play coup. I could sweep and play coup. That wouldn't be a half bad idea. I could... I got a lot of coin control. I'm actually liking how much coin control I have. I just need to keep you from getting more control. So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to... Ooh, that would be kind of nice, wouldn't it? I'm going to sweep into... This is kind of dangerous, I'm leaving it a little open. I'm going to sweep from Kanto into Qianyang. And that's really... Wait, do I want to do that? Or am I going to take guys out of Saigon and do that? Oh, man. See, I have a lot of guys in Saigon. I could try to make a push for Quang Duc, but that's... Or Tay Nin, but those are dangerous places. And An Lok is about to be under attack. What to do? I think I will sweep into An Lok. So I'm going to take my... And the reason I can do that is because sweep lets you either go to an adjacent space, or you can take an LOC to an adjacent space, right? So, like, I can take this LOC Route 13 coming out of Saigon in the north and move guys into An Lok. Even though, technically, An Lok is not adjacent, you know, by Saigon, I can take that LOC and move up. So you've brought in some pretty good firepower here, so I think I'm going to start bringing in my guys. We're going to take guys out of Saigon here. I probably shouldn't just let this gorilla in Saigon hang out, but I'm going to let him do that for a little bit. Oh, this is true. Should I just sweep in Saigon, or should I just move guys in An Lok? Actually, I'm going to change my mind. I'm just going to sweep in Saigon, because I can't let you keep destroying stuff in Saigon. You can have An Lok. So what I'll sweep in Saigon, and we'll expose this gorilla. You'll probably be able to put guys in because it's passive opposition, so you'll be able to do what you need to do to fix that, but we'll just try to keep you wasting your time and resources on that. That's sort of the goal. Sometimes you do these things just to force a move, right? Like sometimes I'll do that and I know you can just easily turn him back underground or put more guys there because it's a space with opposition. But I'm gonna make you do that. Otherwise I'm gonna try to assault and get it later. So we'll just sweep in place there. We'll get rid of that movement thing. That cost me 3. I'm starting to get a little lower on money. And is that all I want to sweep into? Is there? I don't really want to pay more.
I gotta do something about this coin control business.
Alright, so here's what I'm gonna do. I'm actually gonna do it in two places. I'm gonna sweep in Saigon and in Lok. So I'm gonna pay another 3 resources. I'm gonna go to 21. And I am going to take those 6 guys. We're going to come up to An Lok. Just so I can get coin control back there and actually have a presence in An Lok and Saigon. So that's what I'll do. I'll spend a little bit more, but I'll try to be in 2 places. So you can see I'm kind of starting to run out of money. So I've got 21, which means I have, 7 actions left, because each one costs me 3. So yeah. I have to start thinking about, like, oh, man, getting a little bit more chill here, because you can prosecute the war only so far before you just start running out of money.
Yeah.
All right, so that's what I'll do there for that. It'll be that. So that's my turn.
All right, so for me, pretty much all I can do is either limited op or limited op and event.
You can actually only do limited op, or you can pass.
Okay. Ineligible. What's this next card? There's no reason for me to even think.
Right, as a BC, you're not going to get... It's not going to be likely.
Alright, so we're going to go for limited operation then.
Okay.
And then, let's see. What about limited operations? I need to get some more gorillas out there, or I could march.
You can march places for free on LOCs, or and because it's a limited op, you can only pick one place to march to.
Does NVA control, does it count the Viet Cong?
No, it only counts straight up NBA, because the VC go for uncontrolled. That's what they're trying to do. I mean, they're just trying to, they don't care about control, you know, they care about opposition. So their pieces don't count, I towards NVA. They do count towards coin control. So, like, if you had NVA and BC in a space, then that means the US or Arvin has got to add all those people together and have more than them combined to get control. But NVA only counts itself. So you can march. One thing you can do also is rally in Saigon, and because you have a base there, you could put 7 guerrillas into Saigon.
Yeah, I was thinking about it.
But yeah, you can march or rallies or, yeah. See, this is where the BC gets dangerous. Now you have a base in Saigon. This is going to make you tough to deal with. Because the other thing is the U.S. can't airstrike cities. I should have mentioned that. You can't launch an airstrike in a city, obviously, because that would just be terrible. So
yeah.
It's much tougher to fight in cities in a way.
I think for right now, or flip any VC guerrillas there underground.
Mm-hmm.
So I could just flip that guerrilla back upside down.
Yes.
That's what we're gonna do.
Okay.
My gorilla has reestablished his deal.
His deal. So yeah, I mean, you can move him underground. You could put just 7 new guys in there and have him active, but yeah, also
that would
just
open me up, I think, too easily for you to come in and take more control of more places.
Yeah, possibly.
So I'm trying to play a bit of a conservative game, which as insurgency, I probably don't want to be doing that, but I don't know.
Well, the truth is, like, I mean, just even having a guy in Saigon is the pain. Like, even flipping him over, it's just now I gotta sweep him again and hopefully try to do something. I mean, it takes a lot of effort now that we're not, especially now that the faction order has gone kind of a, you know, insurgent, counter-insurgent kind of flow. It's gonna be a lot tougher to get that back under control.
Okay, so I think, is that the end of that card?
That is the end of that card.
Alright.
Yeah, so you can move everybody over and hit the next card. Or flip eligibility and next card.
So end faction play, then end card play?
No, do end faction play and then do... What is end card play? What does that do, actually? Resets eligibility cylinders. I wonder if that'll actually... That might just... I wonder if that'll work. Yeah, go ahead and end faction play, and then let's hit that, and we'll see what's up.
End card play?
Yeah, let's see what this does.
Ah!
Oh, beautiful. Wow.
Useful.
That is actually really useful. No more dragging. Yeah, and then you can hit
Draw card.
Oh, I see how this is doing that now. Okay, so when you hit in card play, it actually moves us to the discard pile. That's what if you go to current, it'll have a bunch of cards there, or it did, but now it's moved them all up there. So that's what that does. That makes sense now.
Yeah.
So just going to say, we've been doing this for a while. Would you mind maybe maybe stopping for today, taking a break?
Yeah, I've heard this. So this will save, right?
Yes, I can do a save file. You can as well. So it's just up there and hit save game.